number one, door number two, and door number three.
Hey there, welcome to Atomic Bark. I'm James DC, and I have two fantastic guests. I just want to say thank you to my engineer James, who is here today. Today we're going to be talking about punk rock, all kinds of punk. I'm here with singer and musician and artist Anne Pigalle, and Glen Matlock, musician, legendary musician, now and always, obviously, with the Sex Pistols. Shouldn't need to know that. But anyway, in case you've had your head in the sand for the last 475 years. We're just going to talk about punk in general. We're going to talk about its influence, whether it still exists, whether it ever actually existed at all. Was it something that was created by the media, Malcolm McLaren, or was it a conglomeration of spontaneous events and things going on, socio-political things going on? There's the whole music. I mean, it's really, punk has been incredibly influential on politics, fashion, arts, literature. But, you know, what's happening with it now? You've got this thing going on with the Pussy Riots right at the moment. They're the sort of modern version and spirit of punk, and they're going to maybe go away for 7 years for doing a punk-type performance in a Catholic church in Russia. So what's going on? You've got the appropriation of punk. You've got, you know, these sort of rubbishy bands like, you know, Green Day.
There's too many, I mean, to mention.
You know, yeah, Green Day. Maybe Glenn knows them, so I'm sorry if you do, but, you know, they're not punk. That's not punk to me. That's just rock music. So there's lots of questions. I won't bang on because punk is a massive subject, but we'll get into it. Glenn, thank you so much for coming on.
My pleasure.
And obviously, you are a complete legend. I'm very privileged, and so is Anne. She's a legend, but I know Anne already. I've met you first time tonight. Actually, I saw you in the VIP room at the Stooges.
Sounds like me. Yeah.
Yeah, it was always you at the Stooges gig about, I don't know, 3 years ago at Hammersmith.
Oh, when I made that fantastic comeback with James Williamson playing with them for
That's
the first
right.
time. Yeah, that was great. Yeah. Great show. That.
Yeah.
That was a real reaffirmation of rock music for me that night.
Really?
Yeah, it was great. And I know James. I worked with him when I was playing with Iggy Pop in 1979, and James was producing the album. Him and Iggy had a big bust-up, and James not only walked out of the studio, he walked out of the music business for 30 years, and he had hardly picked up a guitar until he got the call to rejoin the Stooges after poor old Ron Ashton passed away.
Yeah.
And I'd kind of been party to that, and then to go and see him play and knowing the whole story, it was something else. And also, I was sitting watching it with Patty Paladin and Noel Fielding's mum, who I'd never met before, who's a right laugh. So
yeah,
it was a good night all round. You
know? Yeah, because Noel Fielding was there,
yeah.
Wasn't he? Yeah, we blagged into the VIP room, me and my girlfriend.
Oh, that's quite punk.
Yeah, very punk. Whoa. And I was going to say hello, but it was a bit of a quiet VIP party. It wasn't very wild, was it? But
well,
there you go.
There you go. Don't know what you expect from these things.
You've done everything already, so you don't need to worry.
Yeah, done that. Got several T-shirts in a box.
So, bet they're worth a lot of money. Now, what's your current band, Glenn, and what's going on with you musically, professionally at the moment or whatever?
I don't really know exactly what I'm doing at the moment. I've got a band called The Philistines. We put out a few records under that guys. We've got a show coming up in London. We're doing the the Half Moon in Putney on the 23rd, and we're playing a show at Vowood Literary Festival up in Norfolk on the 26th. No, so we're playing on the 24th and the 26th. I do some solo shows, acoustic things. I'm playing at the Stromerville thing next weekend. I've just been touring in the States. I just do whatever comes up that's... looks interesting. There's a bit of travel involved, and a couple of few bobs helps as well, you know.
So it's just keeping your hand in it, really, you know.
Yeah, but then I play with different. I did a tour with Hugh Cornwall earlier on in the year of the States, and I got this other little project with called the International Swingers. We did a tour of California. Oh, I don't know, about a month and a half ago, we finished. It's Clem Burke from Blondie in it, and a guy called James Stevenson, who plays guitar with me, but is also on the Alarm and. Was in Gene Love Jezebel, and he plays in Chelsea. And there's a guy called Gary Twin, who's in the 20 Flight Rockers. And we're just mates. We go and play covers, but we cover our own songs. So I get to play a few Blondie songs with Clem, and he gets to play some Pistol stuff and Richie's stuff with me. It's fun, you know.
Excellent.
But I like to keep playing. You know, to me, yeah. Music is about... is the live experience in front of an audience, and it's when people pick up on what you're doing.
That's the best.
That's the thing, you know, when you can see the whites of their eyes, it's kind of better.
Because it's the real thing, you know, at the end of the day.
Well, it's the acid test, you know. You can sit at home and write a song in your little bedroom or wherever you do it, and it's all in your mind. But until you see somebody's reaction, which you don't even get from a record, because they people go off and listen with their iPhones and iPods... in their own private dream world, but it's that live experience is what gets me in.
Let me ask this, on
Glenn's point. Mm-hmm. You know, with the digital world of music, as Glenn was saying, somebody can be, they can produce a masterpiece from their bedroom on their laptop now, but it's not a lot.
A masterpiece is to be questioned.
Yeah, a few. Yeah, but, you know, it's got to be about the live experience for you.
Well, I mean, I guess I have to make a point here, you know, why I'm here today to talk about punk, because most people probably know me as the last chanteuse. But in 1976 is the first time that I saw Glenn play. You know, I saw the Sex Pistols play in Paris at the Chalet du Lac. And I was a very young teenager. And for me, it was, you know, one of the most exciting things, because I was a young kid and I was, you know, a bit traumatized. A teenager, and it taught me, yes, you too can pick up a guitar, and so that's the whole point, you know. You can play some instrument, you can play it in front of people, you know, and you can express what you have to express. After that, well, what goes through a studio is a different thing. It's a different job, it's a different experience, you know, but to be able to do it in front of people, to me, is the most important and the most exciting thing.
Yeah, but I don't think one precludes the other.
You still have to make records and stuff.
It's all part and parcel of...
Sure.
But I'm saying for me, it's really, you know, what's the best.
I mean,
it's
you're a big Edith Piaf fan, and I like some of her stuff, and I really like Jacques Brel and people like that. But we're never, ever going to get to see them, so unless they've made some records...
But it was interesting to know that at this time, you know, people didn't have a multi-track studio. You know, they just recorded in a kind of live way, you know. And you know, I'm not sure you can say the records today that are so well produced are better than the ones that
I think that's going off on a tangent a little bit. I think one of the problems for me with records today, it's like the quest for perfection. And to me, you know, anybody can play an A chord or a D chord or a G chord, but what gives it its character is when people used to play live a bit more and were a bit sloppy about it. But that's where the character and the feel of the music came through, and we're kind of losing that a little bit. I mean, I get to listen to quite a lot of new bands, because I've got young sons who are into bands like You, Me at Six and New Found Glory, and I don't know, there's a whole host of bands with three-word names. But they all sound pretty similar to me, and I don't know if that's like an old guy talking, but I actually think it's because they're all really overproduced and it's all auto-tuned, and it's really hard to tell the difference.
Well, in that sense, I'll put my cynical hat on for a moment. And, you know, the punk sort of attitude, it's certainly in rock music, do you think it's pretty much dead now, or it's only in in the obscure little bands, people like Pussy Riot and etc. I mean, you're saying that everything's overproduced. I mean, they've obviously got suits running and everything. It's very corporate.
Well, not everything is. It's just the attitude behind it. But then I suppose if I go in a studio, I still want it to sound as good as possible. So you kind of fall into that trap of making it, the quest for perfection. But I think the next thing I do, I'm just going to rehearse with a band and then go and cut stuff live. Just to give it some of that feel back. You know. I mean, like, one of the best records ever is My Generation by The Who, and that was recorded in a three-hour session.
Sure.
But it sounds so good because they'd actually demoed it so many times and played it live and then just went in and did it. You know?
It's the same as the Beatles. You know, they did a lot of takes, you know, two or three takes, and that was it. It was incredible how they made albums in those days. But anyway, let's get on to the punk thing. I mean, basically, in terms of, I'll ask you that question, Anne. You know, do you think punk is still alive in spirit, or did it ever exist, or is it just we fabricated it?
Well, you're talking about these little new punk bands and all that, but the point is that when punk happened, it was new. It was a new sound, you know. So obviously after that, everybody's going to try to copy that. So in a way, you know, punk happened at the time. And I mean, you know, whoever invented it is not really important. The point is that it happened and it was exciting because it was now and it was people saying something. If you're going to try to recreate something, it's never going to be the same. And the problem with today is that it is in fashion, in film, in art, in music. Everybody tries to recreate something. Everybody tries to appropriate, you know. The big thing is appropriation. Copy people seems to be hip. But, you know, the problem is that right now everybody's starting to see that there is a problem with a society, you know, this thing about being famous and being rich. And it seems that it's the only thing that people care about. And the whole point is that, you know, every interesting musical creation has been going against society. You know, it's always been going against the grain. You can only create something exciting if it goes against, not if it's a copy and paste job, which, you know, I won't mention names, but a lot of famous singers do now. And that's totally uncool. And I'm sure we're going to come back to, well, I hope we're going to come back to a more, you know, sincere approach, because it's the only thing that's, you know, vibrant, you know, that actually means something. So that's, you know, I think, you know, punk was then, you know, jazz was then, you know, and it's nice that some people can play jazz, some people can play punk, but I hope for something new and interesting.
Well, for me, the idea, Glenn, I don't know, thanks, Anne. Glenn, I don't know whether you agree with this, but for me, punk, again, it's a mental state. I mean, obviously, there are the accoutrements of punk. Obviously, it did exist in that sense. You know, you were one of the main people behind it. But, it, you know, the look and the style and the type of music, etc. But for me, you know, you look at the Dadaists in 1918 with their Cabaret Voltaire, that's where they got the name from, the band. You know, they were punk, weren't they?
Well, I was just going to say that. I think there's a whole slew of people who were punks but weren't called punks. Your Edith Piafs and your Frank Zappas and your Jim Morrison's and who was that bloke who did Brand New Cadillac in France?
Chuck Berry.
No.
You're
a DJ.
The one that Vince Taylor.
Vince Taylor, completely out there.
Yeah, he was incredible. And you know, they signed him up because they didn't want him to be a competition to other singers. Yeah. You know, the usual. You know, the problem is that, you know, the great people, sometimes they have the luck to come out, and sometimes, you know, they have to fight against the money grabbing, you know, system. And you know, bravo to the to the girl, you know, who said no to Putin, because people don't do that now.
No,
you know,
it's incredible.
Yeah, that's a
done.
Very brave thing. I don't think they really thought the ramifications through. I think they'll get off, but I think they'll, you know, they'll be taught a very hard lesson, but I think they'll get off ultimately.
Well, yeah, maybe.
I hope so, you know. But
now, I'm being mega cynical here. I don't really think this, but I was thinking, I wonder if they wanted to become massively famous overnight.
I think they just didn't think it through, did it?
Yeah.
And well.
But you know, that brings me on to the other point I was going to ask you. I'll ask you in second hand, you know, but about this idea of appropriation. Every sort of revolution in the youth gets appropriated. The 60s hippie revolution became t-shirts, punk almost within a year was a kind of already a label. And then you had the kind of acid rave culture in the 90s. We haven't had anything for about 20 years. It's all gone a bit dead. But do you think
I think people have run out of ideas a little bit. You know, it's in everything, what I was saying earlier on, but what seems to constitute being new now is a little bit of this and a little bit of that and a little bit of that
put together.
It's not new. But people think it is. But,
well, it's collage.
But, you know, I kind of was... It was collage, yeah. But, you know, even back then, even the pistol stuff... A little bit was kind of collage.
Sure.
And, you know, you mentioned, well, perhaps you didn't, but, like, you know, somebody like Marcel Duchamp. I was looking for a riff for the song Pretty Vacant. I had a really good song, but I knew I needed something else for it. And I heard an idea from somewhere. And because I was at art school at the time, I thought it was kind of cool to borrow an idea as a kind of a ready-made thing and slotted it in and it fitted the bill. But back then, the trick was to... make it seem more kind of organic and part of it and not wear your heart on your sleeve, oh, I nicked this, as when sampling came in. But then again, the whole technology has driven each kind of movement. You know, you had house music. Well, that wouldn't have happened if you didn't have Atari computers and little sequencer packages and the sampler where you nicked ideas
from. Then maybe in that sense, punk was the last sort of rock music movement that wasn't driven by technology per se, you know?
No, but I kind of almost think it was in a way.
But well,
exactly
what? Was,
what?
Well, but they didn't use synthesizer or anything like that, did they? They kept to the same kind of three.
No,
chords.
But in a way, it was almost kind of quite reactionary because I've never really understood the full meaning of that word, but. We was react against the overblownness
yeah,
of
that's right.
prog,
yeah,
yeses yeah. and prog
yeah,
rock
yeah, okay.
and stuff.
Okay, sure,
but
I see what you mean
statement.
Now. And what did you want to say?
Sorry,
you're chomping at the bit. It's all right. So what did you want to say to Glenn's point?
No, because it's okay to use. It's okay to be inspired, and it's okay to use other people's ideas if you create something new. But what people are doing today, they're not creating something new with the appropriation. They're just ripping off, you know, and look. Lawyers have a hard time at the moment because people say, I didn't repeat off, I just got inspired, you know, but there's a difference between creating something new with the old or just copy and pasting, which is what this fashion, you know, gurus do for singers today, you know. And because of the internet, it's very easy to rip ideas off, you know, on the internet, you know, it's very quick. So, you know, that's the thing. And the whole point of punk is that it went against the system and the music business by saying we can do something simply and it's fun, you know, and didn't need the big, you know, production of the time, you know, and I know because, you know, I had the experience of having done something with the big production and, you know, I don't come from there and it wasn't me and I thought, well, I was going to say the word I'm not supposed to say, you know, I just said no because... That's not it to me, you know, and that's you know, the rapper with the life thing, the idea that it is some more organic creation, and then you can patch it up.
Sure.
But, you know, I'm saying something is the beginning of a creation, you know, I have something to say. You know, if I just steal things and put a brand new dress on, that's not somebody who has something
saying,
to say.
So you're saying, I mean,
you know?
In a way, do you think that punk was... It was obvious it was a lot more political, wasn't it? It was making a statement.
Well, it was political.
I mean, I don't know how,
yeah, but
how punk
you
is...
You can't divorce when punk, as punk is known, came through in the mid to late 70s. You can't divorce it from the time that it was in, you know.
Sure.
I mean, I always say this, and it kind of gets a bit tedious, but it's true. You know, the state of England at the time, and perhaps it's echoed now, but... You know, London was a dump for a kid. There was nothing was open. The pubs used to shut during the afternoon. Everything shut at 11. That was it, unless you had loads of money. And there's rubbish piled high in the streets. Everybody was on strike. There was power cuts. There was a real air of despondency around. It's not the same now. People are skint, but, you know, in Olympics London. But there's so many other kind of diversions. People think they're skint because they haven't got the latest iPhone. It's different, you know.
Sure.
Yeah. It's not starvation.
Still people
it's mental.
Who are suffering from poverty that we don't necessarily meet in Islington or whatever. So I think, you know, I think we kind of, that's a whole other story.
But well,
I think,
there always were, but yeah. But it was, there always was in London as well.
Sure.
You know, it was really apparent. So the people up north and when all the shipyards were being shut down, the factories were being closed. You know, but it's a different thing. You know, we was on the cusp of England losing its place as a manufacturing base, and it was beginning to turn into a service industry. Now it's been a service industry for years, and it's just different.
Well,
you know.
Yeah.
But again, back to the whole punk thing. You know, the thing that I was involved in was the Sex Pistols, and we never saw ourselves as a punk band. We just saw ourselves as the Sex Pistols. The punk thing came after that, and it was people kind of hanging on to our, it was a label that was put on us, and all the kind of more second division bands came along, they were more happy to be known as punk bands.
So you've probably been asked this 1,000 times. I'm going to ask
probably,
you for 1,001th time. That's not a word, but anyway, 1,001st. I mean, did you actually have any idea, apart from McLaren kind of orchestrating things in his own way? I know you were all as valid as he was. There's a whole debate about that, but in terms of, you know, creating the Pistols, but did you guys literally think we're going to kind of be really anarchistic, we're going to be quite political, we are going to wear green hair, we're going to create something new, or was it all kind of spontaneous?
No, I think it was all spontaneous. We all put our own bit to the pot that we wanted to do. We all wanted to do something different. What Malcolm did more than anything else was provided a base. Yeah, he had the wackiest whacked out shop down the wrong end of the King's Road when everything like Granny Takes a Trip and Alcashire and all those things were supposed to be hit, but he was doing the antithesis of all that. And anybody who wanted to move on kind of gravitated to Malcolm's shop, again, on a Saturday afternoon because the pubs were shut. You know, that's why people went there. But we all met up through there and we all brought our own little bit to the table and we knew exactly what we didn't want to do. We didn't know what we did want to do. We didn't know what we didn't want to do. And Grotton's lyric, you know, don't know what I want, but I know how to get it. You know, that kind of sums the whole kind of thing up. Really. And it was through a process of negation that we ended up with something kind of positive.
Well, that's really interesting. Is letting me ask Anne on this. You know, the fact that I think that's brilliant, actually, saying that they didn't want it, they didn't really know what they wanted, but they were reacting against something, as you say, going against the grain. Whereas maybe in the modern culture now, everything is kind of available in many ways, the digital culture, and there's kind of, you can always find your niche sort of interest. You know, if you go on the internet, you can find some obscure krautrock band from proto krautrock band from 1968 in Cologne or whatever. Before, no, it would have been about 63 because that can and all those were already happening. They were kind of punk. But, you know, nowadays you can find that. Whereas, in as Glenn was saying, in the mid sort of early 70s, you didn't have all this information to hand, did you? You had to create it for yourself.
But on the other end, there was a kind of, we used to have 4 music magazines that come out every week that sold like 100,000 copies at least, which you don't get anymore. So there was other ways of finding things. Mm. It was full of a load of poo, basically.
Yeah.
I remember somebody from France saying, "Oh, Glenn, I must come to London. You are so lucky." And I said, "Why?" And they said, "They have all these bands playing, you know, the Red Cow and Hammersmith and the Torrington in Finchley, and it looks so great from a distance." But, you know, most of them are really rank pub rock bands. In fact, I think it was Jean-François Chopin.
I remember him.
And then I remember actually when punk was starting up, and we was kind of looking out, or when we were starting up as the Sex Pistols, we were looking out for kind of like-minded beasts, and there was a band playing, I don't know, in somewhere in Islington, the Teenage Rebels, and me and Bernard Rhodes went to watch them. And they were like something off of Rock Follies or something like that. And Bernard was really annoyed that we'd gone all the way over to see him, and I wasn't that happy either. We went up to him afterwards, and Bernard said, "Well, I thought you was supposed to be Teenage Rebels." You know, and they weren't. And the guy turned round to Bernard and he said, "Well, that's it, we're rebelling against teenagers." And Bernard was speechless. But, you know, there was all these things going on that just didn't cut the mustard.
I'll ask you both this actual question. I'll ask Glen first. Who for you was the main influence musically? Or was it? Were you very eclectic?
No, I mean
for punk, let's say.
What really inspired me, and you know, I was born in the '50s. We never used to have a Radio One. All we had was a light program. Bear with me on this.
Right? No, I know.
The only time you could hear pop music was on the Brian Matthews show on a Saturday morning when he played the hits, interspersed with comedy clips from Hancock's Half Hour and Hugh and I and silly programmes like, and Jimmy Savile on a Sunday afternoon who played the Top 40, which I always thought as a young kid was daft. How do you know what the Top 40 is if you never got a chance to hear all the other records? But I suppose I was a bit too young. And then you had Radio Luxembourg. Now, that weren't kind of enough. And then to cater for that, you had all these pirate radio stations sprung up, you know, Caroline, London, broadcasting on boats in the North Sea, just outside territorial waters. And that coincided with bands like The Kinks, The Who, The Beatles, The Rolling Stones, The Yardbirds, The Idle Race, things like that coming through. And it was a really, really exciting time. 2.5, 3-minute slices of pure rock recorded on valve systems. And it was great. That's what inspired me.
Really?
And that was kind of deep in my
bones.
Yes, I could feel it in my
John
water,
Peel,
man.
Obviously.
But it's, that know. Was much later, you know, that Did, was much
yeah,
later.
Yeah, right, you're talking about the really early stuff.
Yeah, but that was my yardstick for doing my bet on a Pistols song.
And were you really influenced by the, what they say, the proto-punk bands as like the 60s garage bands?
Well, I was kind of aware of them, you know, I was aware of the Stooges. I was fortunate enough to, I was a big fan of the Faces, who I was lucky enough to be playing with over the last couple of years. Like a version of it, and it was kind of cool. But I actually went to see them when I was about 16, when I was working at Malcolm Shop at Wembley. I didn't know who else or really cared who else was on the bill, but I went to get my money's worth anyway. The first band was the Pink Fairies, whose time had been gone and not quite arrived in the meantime. Middle of the bill was the New York Dolls. The original New York Dolls were Billy Mercer, the drummer. This is not about a week before he died. So I got to see them and then the Faces. And that was like a real life-changing experience gig because I had a bit of everything from what was purportedly going on. The Faces were great, but,
sure.
You know, their time, they'd kind of reached the zenith of their thing playing at Wembley.
Yeah.
And there was this band, New York Dolls, so that was like, well. But we was already beginning to get really early days getting the Pistols thing together.
I mean, I suppose...
And so it kind of... I don't know, it kind of ticked the box that actually I was kind of on the right track to what we was trying to do.
Well, I believe there's always something in the ether, in the zeitgeist almost, and vibes are rebounding around, and everybody kind of, you get that a lot of the time. You get that like in the Parisian arts movements in the 20s, you know, you got Dada and surrealism and all other kinds of things going on in music. It's very similar. And the same with the punk. As you say, I think that people are already getting... there's always the argument, what do you think about this, Sam, about the, you know, oh, it is the Americans who started punk, you know, like with television and Patti Smith. And then other people go, no, it was the British, you know, with Dr. Feelgood and Ian Dury's Kilburn and the High Roads, etc.
Well, no,
I think
it's
it was
all part
both.
Of,
you know, I think
it's all
it was
part
both.
Of the same picture, but, I mean, at the end of the day, you know, I don't think that's really important. The point is that something was trying to say something, and you know, whoever it was and whichever way, you know, I think for me the Sex Pistols it was very important to me because it rang in my French culture. It was closer to, you know, in our culture we had revolution, you know, the Dadaist, the Surrealist, the Situationist, Alfred Jarry, you know, who really was very close to this, Situationist. And first of all, the very first cabarets in Paris, you know, at the turn of the century, which actually, you know, were really the first one to offer a show to people where they invited, you know, the a bourgeoisie and were saying extremely provocating, you know, poems and songs, you know, basically insulting, you know, people. And it wasn't like records at the time. It was in a very small place, you know. And to me, this is really the kind of beginning, you know, that in our culture, we have, you know, a tradition of saying at the people at the top, you know, right. of you just telling yeah. them, you know, we've had enough, you know. So to me, that was, you know, that was what appealed to me.
Well, look, that's a very good point. Hang on, Glen, just follow this point a minute. Why do you think punk didn't, if it was that kind of radical in that sense in France, why didn't it really originate in France then, punk? Why was it more Anglo-American?
Well, because, it was a different time, and so the political climate in England was, you know, appropriate to it, and in America they did it in a different way, you know, but it was more political here. You know, and it always starts from that, isn't it? I mean, all great music is political statement. I mean, jazz, you know, it was because in America people didn't like black people. I mean, you know, it always comes from a very serious...
It's usually political then, basically. That's the absolutely. Fundamental thing.
Absolutely.
Glen, sorry, what were you going to say?
I can't remember now. I was just going to have a comedy interjection. In fact, when we went to Paris to play for the first time, two things I couldn't believe. I remember Malcolm took us out for a walk round by the Sorbonne, you know, Odeon Way kind of thing. And I remember saying to Malcolm, hey, Malcolm, look, they know the names of our songs already because they had Anarchy written on the wall. And I really didn't know, right? There was that, which was kind of... Then he explained to me and I thought, right, OK. But then the other thing, I remember getting the Metro and I just couldn't believe that France, that had the sort of biggest revolution in England, still had first class on the Metro.
You know,
it's kind of this funny dichotomy between the
bourgeois.
Well,
of course,
but
always, right? Yeah. You know.
See, I mean...
But I was going to go on to say something else then. It must have been good. But yeah, what I am saying, it doesn't matter whether it started in America or England first. I think actually what happened is that people, both sides of our kind of age group, or the Americans are always that little bit older, cottoned on that little bit later, everybody got fed up with the same things at the same time, both sides of the Atlantic. And I mean, you know, I'd heard about this band, the Ramones, because Malcolm had brought flyers back, and he brought back flyers of the Heartbreakers when Richard Hell was in the band, you know, and it was a list of songs, you know, the Blank Generation and In the Arms of Venus de Milo, which was kind of funny. As a good old art school boy, I knew that she didn't have any arms in the statue, you know, it was kind of weird. But I hadn't made any records, so we hadn't heard them. And we hadn't made any records. So when the Ramones come to England for the first time, we went to see them. It was like, wow, you know, they're pretty much on the same page as us.
And do you think the Pistols were as influenced by the later punk bands, say, in America, to develop their own style, or did you kind of do it all hermetically sealed in your own thing? Or
we weren't influenced by the punk bands because we hadn't heard them. The only one thing that we would have heard, and we actually did a version of it, and it was because we were like the hip kids in the hippest place in London, knocking around with the hippest people. Nick Kent, who was the star writer for The Enemy at the time, was mates with Malcolm, and he used to come and hang out with us. And he gave us a cassette, which a mate of his, John Cowell, had given him, of this band that he'd been producing. And it was like half the album, which didn't come out for another year. And it was Jonathan Richman and Modern Lovers with Roadrunner. We did that song even before it was released because we was in the right place at the right time with the right guys, man. Thank you very much. Things like that we were hip to, but we also brought loads of other things to the table.
But
the very common ground with me, Steve and Paul, where I joined the band because we all dug the faces. Steve liked the Heartbreakers and the Dolls more than I did. We was all kind of hip to the Stooges. Paul liked Tamla Motown as I did. John hated all that stuff. He liked all the progressive rock, you know, Van de Graaff Generator and a bit of Common Ground. I like Captain Beefheart too. And he liked some of the German bands. One of the best gigs I ever saw was Cannes at Hammersmith Palais.
Oh, I'm so jealous of
and,
you.
And they were great. But God, there was all this stuff going on. And then after the Pistols, after we did the Bill Grundy show, there was notices going up in Scout Huts and pubs social centres all around the country, you know, we're forming a punk band, we're punks, you must come and join our punk band, oh, by the way, you must be a punk. It became very kind of narrow, but we had a load of stuff, there's a whole load of stuff in there,
which
gives it its kind of majesty.
But just to continue that point quickly, I'll come to you, Anna, in a sec, but, you know, obviously you had a whole sort of all different various influences and it wasn't really punk as it was seen at the time when you were creating punk. But what I mean is, like, as it developed across the Atlantic as well, you know, in the sort of like a year or two after you'd formed, near towards the end perhaps, were you being influenced when you played live by some of the later punk bands, like, say, I don't know, Television or...
No.
Or you were just... We just
did what we did.
You did what you did.
And all the stuff that we did was kind of written in a very short period.
Sure.
From 75 to 76.
So, yeah, I'm sorry, I'm wrong on that, because you're correct, because most of it was done in the first... Of course you are. But what I'm forgetting, that's what I'm saying, I'm forgetting that most of it was done in like a year, and then you just played most of that live, didn't you?
And then it all sort of imploded or exploded. I think maybe bands like the Clash come along, you know, they kind of had a chance to grow, and like... But whether they'd like Television, my neighbours into other things, you know, they got the chance to travel as a band and sort of hang out in New York and get up to the kind of the beatbox rap thing that was coming in. And Mick kind of definitely got involved in that and introduced that to the band. You know, and they kind of had a breadth as well. Whether they picked up on Television is another matter.
Sure. I mean, that was just an example. But I see what you're saying, of course. And, I mean, in terms of this appropriation idea, you know, of punk, I mean, do you think people... Maybe you assume that young kids in America think that Lady Gaga is punk. Is she punk?
Well, I don't want to talk about that. I think it's a waste of time. You know, I think it's more important to talk about, you know, what's happening, like, for example, the Olympic Games.
Yeah, well, let's talk about that.
Because talk about appropriation. I mean, you know, I mean, everybody's mentally lazy, you know. I mean, I don't use rude words, but I think
that's pretty rude. Everybody is mentally lazy.
No, you know, the young generation, they have this thing where you know, they don't dig things for themselves. They don't search for this very, you know, specific little magical bit. You know, they want it all served on a plate, which is what the computers give, and they don't even buy records anymore. It's that unimportant to them, you know, and you know, that there is a mental, you know, an intellectual cultural starvation, because, you know, everybody's being brain fed that, you know, what is important is that they have to be rich and they have to be famous. Being happy, no, that's not important, you know, but everybody knows that, you know. I mean, I know sufficient amount of rich people to know that, you know, that's not necessarily the key to happiness. But of course it serves the people who are brainwashing, because they are so insecure, you know, I kind of pity them, that they think it's what is making them happy.
So,
but it's bullshit.
So you
know?
Think in terms of punk, you know, it's just become another label, it's just another it's another track on the iPod, and that's it. There's no kind of teeth left in this dog.
At the moment, I think it's you know, but because of that, at the same time, I hope there's going to be a kind of a backlash. It's going to be tough, because more and more, you know, everything, you know, is controlled by computer. We are controlled by computers. So it's becoming, you know, more and more difficult to be a personal, you know, but it doesn't take a lot of people. You know, it can take 10 people. It can take 10 people to start something.
Well, look at the Occupy movements recently. I thought that was quite punk. You know, and I was really surprised by that, because I've been waiting for this kind of backlash for, you know, 20 years or more. I think the acid rave was the last kind of cultural social movement that was kind of against the establishment. The bad things about the establishment, not everything is bad about the establishment, of course, but that was the last thing. And I think, you know, we've been waiting for something to happen. And I think the digital culture makes that difficult, because people talk on Facebook now. They don't go down the pub and go, yeah,
let's take the Facebook case. You know, when there was the first demonstration of Pussy a riot here, right? Thousands of people on Facebook said that they were going to go, right? Thousands, we're going to be there. I went. There was about 15 people.
Really?
There. Yeah, that shows that it's the Facebook wank, you know. You know, I mean, that shows, because you can hide, you know, it's not person to person, you know, it's easy to be a coward. It's easy to steal, it's easy to hide, it's easy to be a... You know what, you know. And so, you know, the backlash will be probably in a different shape, in a different form, because it's a different a generation, it's a different time. But surely people don't want to be taken for stupid the rest of their lives, which is what's happening. It's what's happening.
You've got a point there. Yeah. I agree with that. But on the other hand, one of the things with the internet is... you know, the Arab Spring, a lot of that was fed by
exactly,
people
yeah.
talking yeah. when they couldn't do yeah. on the
no,
internet.
I mean,
you know,
there
so
is
there's,
a good side.
And, there's good and
yeah.
bad points
yeah, there is a good
to
side,
it. There's good
but,
and
but
bad
the bad
points.
Side is big, you know, because we, before we didn't have the computers, but somehow, if there was something exciting, people would know about it.
Well, in a way,
you know.
In a way, Let It Rock, or whatever, there was, it was McLaren's shop at the time. Was it Let It Rock or before it was called Sex? You were working
yeah, it was
there,
weren't
you?
Yeah.
And in a way, that was the kind of Facebook of London for you guys.
Yeah,
you all congregated,
that, yeah.
and that's where you got your ideas from.
Yeah, you know, and the only kind of real commitment you had to make was to actually go there, which is quite a big thing, and buy at least a pair of Dayglo socks, you know, to buy a bit more time in the places, which people did, you know.
I mean, I think this is
so
interesting.
So you make a kind of commitment. And again, talking about buying records, I think kids do buy records, actually. I know, because I've got kids and I end up paying for them.
Yeah, but it's very much black and white. You know, you have the big stars who sell tons of records. And before, there was a bit of a medium, you know, where bands were not so known, but they could make a kind of a living.
Yeah, and I think it's reflected across society.
Yeah, exactly.
And the rich get richer and the poor
exactly.
get poorer. Is it not always been the way of the world, though?
I don't know. It's always been the way, but maybe not quite as blatant.
More.
And you know, it's obvious that the people have been taken for fools, you know, and how long are they happy to live with that? Don't tell me they're happy to live with that as long as they've got, you know, a brand new pair of shoes. I mean, you know, come on, there is, you know, the spirituality, which is important. You know, it's music is a spiritual thing. Don't tell me that people don't need that, you know, or then it's the end of civilization.
Yeah, well, that's the problem. I mean, when I bang on about how much I love punk, you know, I like all of these sort of movements. People say, oh, you old farts, you know, it's not a big deal. But actually, no, I really think it was actually something that was really revolutionary for the time. Even though you might say, Glenn, that you were just doing your own thing, but it became this political thing.
No, but we knew we was doing something. We didn't know what it was, and we set out to do something. We didn't know what it was.
Yeah.
But we knew that we was doing something.
Yeah, something radical. Yeah, of course. Yeah. You weren't quite sure what it
was,
but you knew you were doing something.
The exciting thing about it was to be with a very small culture of people. Maybe there was 8 people involved with getting the Sex Pistols thing together. You know, the band, Jamie Reed, Malcolm, Vivian, Bernie Rhodes, and that's kind of about it when we first got it together. But to be involved with these people who had a different set of influences or youth or brought other things to the table, whether it was Steve turning up with a bass amp from the Rocky Horror Show here, going here, Glenn, happy birthday, you know, that's your amp. That's where the technological aspect came in. But it was exciting to be in, and then to see it grow. That was the most exciting thing about it.
But do you think it was...
And then as people turned up more and more... It's a measure that you're doing something worthwhile.
Sure.
And the people who turned up were like your Billy Idols, William Broad back then, and Susie, and
the
your Mick Joneses,
and
people like that. Yeah. And then it started growing. And I feel we kind of like dropped a pebble in a pond, and the ripples.
Yeah, totally.
So, and lots of people, you know, even somebody like, you know, the first person to ever book the Sex Pistols was Al McDowell, who you know. Right? When he was at Central School of Art.
Now,
he booked it. I kind of made him, but he became the lifelong friend of all those art to get older sometimes. But then he moved to the States and in Hollywood. He ended up designing Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, the whole set of it. And it's kind of got some kind of punk thing from being that, I think. You know,
oh,
it's pretty whacked out, you know.
It's
but all those, the point I'm making, you know, musicians... fashion designers, people in art, people in the visual arts and things, all, a lot of them, big names now, all had their toes in the water of what was surrounded the Sex Pistols.
Sure.
And I'm proud of that,
I
was involved in
that. Of course, you should pat yourself on the back every day for that. It's brilliant.
Let's make sure.
We're going to pat him on the back now. But no, totally, I think it's incredible. And I think it was phenomenal. I think it's really unique, punk.
Come on, it's the last It's the last.
It's the last
music.
Hurrah.
So far. I dispute that. I think you had the grunge thing since then. I think
you've
got all the every kind of rap stuff.
Sure, yeah.
The acid house thing.
The acid, you got rap and hip-hop, but hip-hop has now become appropriated by corporate culture. That was really kind of radical at the time. I mean, this is the problem. I think.
But then the same thing has happened with punk that we're talking about. Maybe not the Pistols or the Clash, but other people have done that, and then you talk about Green Day, and then they become the watered-down version and sell millions of records. But having said that, I think they're a bit of a comedy rock kind of band, really. I've been to see them a few times because my son likes them, but I still think American Idiot's a great record, and I think that was a very brave song for them to come out with in Bush's America.
Sure.
So you can't take that away.
There's degrees of it, isn't there?
Yeah.
I mean, I suppose I just feel like sometimes in my cynical moments I think it was a wasted opportunity with punk because we could have changed the world. It's like the 60s revolution. They wanted to change the world, and what happened? They kind of got appropriated.
Yeah, but they stopped the Vietnam War, so that's kind of an
issue. About five years after they'd been demonstrating.
It changed it for a short while, you know, and then it goes back to the same, and then you need something else again.
There's nothing new to contest, you know.
So I think what we've gleaned from this discussion is that people have got to keep pushing and pushing and pushing away. You know, don't have the wall pulled over your eyes. And it's always down to the younger generation to do it. And they're not doing it at the moment. So come on, lads, get your act together.
And express yourself.
Let me just ask, you know, a couple more things. We're winding down now. But what do you think about in terms of appropriation of punk by the establishment, what do you think about them playing the Pistols songs at the Olympics opening ceremony?
Well, I had to agree to let them do it, along with the other guys. I think that was fine.
So everybody agreed in the Pistols then?
Yeah.
Okay.
The song was used. They did ask us to play.
Oh, I see.
And
okay.
we didn't.
Okay.
But for various reasons, some political, some just being in the right place at the right time, or fancying it, or getting paid properly for it. You know, there's all those kind of things come into the mix. But I think to have a song that I wrote when I was 19 years old in the thing that's beamed all around the world along with The Who and The Kinks and The Beatles and The Stones and all that is for me, it is a kind of underlining the importance of it.
Sure.
That's the way I see it.
Sure. But then I don't know who said it, but when you were inaugurated into the Rock Museum, the American Rock Museum, I forget, you all kind of said, we don't want to be part of that.
We didn't all say that. John said that, and it's his
more
agenda
John,
at the
really.
Time, and about 2 weeks later he went and accepted an award at the Mojo Awards. So you can read into that what you like, you know.
And are you guys still, apart from doing your tours and all that once in a while,
if we're ever going to do anything again, or might do something next year, I don't know.
But do you keep in touch
Not
with a lot of the punks, you know, the old punk
friends?
What,
the other punks?
Well, apart from the Pistols, you know.
You bump into people and I was in Finland last weekend and ended up getting up playing with Marky Ramone with his thing and, you know, just things like that. You have a common ground with people and, yeah, you go, hi. But I don't knock around with all old punks all the time.
No.
You know, I do actually try and live in the present, as I'm sure Anne does.
I hate the present. I want to live in 1976.
Stop talking about yourself.
Hey, I'm only kidding. I'm kidding. No. No, you know, I always wanted to just have been perhaps part of the punk scene because I was about 10 and my brothers and sisters went punks after having been hippies a few years before. And I think that's an interesting conversation about how a lot of the punks at the time were going, yeah, we hate hippies, you soft idiots and all that, free love. And they actually, I think they both had similar political things going on, the hippies and the punks. Do you think that? Anne, what do you think about that?
I don't know. I was too young for the hippie thing. So
yeah,
for me, you know, it's something that happened in my teenage years. So obviously, you know, that was it. I mean,
in terms of when you, again, do you think if you hadn't seen the Pistols play or kind of got involved in punk when you were 15 or whatever it was, do you think you would never have gone into music?
I think it was definitely very influential for me. I mean, it wasn't the only thing. You know, I'm very influenced by some filmmakers or art. Artist, but yeah, definitely it was, you know, it was, you know, I mean, I know a few people that were there at this gig, you know, and they say, you know, yeah, you know, there hasn't been anything else since that was quite that exciting, you know. Is it because I was so young? No, I think it's because it was.
And did you do the whole kind of stereotype, what we see as stereotypical now, the whole punk thing in 76? You came and lived in London with Glen and other people, didn't you?
Yeah, I had a girls band. And, you know, I was young and I learned my way through things. And through my work today, you know, my art and my music, there is definitely a kind of reflection, you know, because I do my own stuff now, you know. I mean, it's very personal. And so, of course, you know, there's an influence there, no doubt.
But did you wear the kind of the safety pins and all that
stuff?
Well,
you know, it was a French wear, so I had a leather jacket and leather trousers and leopard skin skirt, you know, and stilettos, you know. I mean, it was the French wear, you know, so each country had it a bit in their own style. But because, you know, my friend Al, you know, who was best friend with Glen, you know, he used to work for Sex, so... You know, he gave me some of the clothes as well. So, I still have photographs from the time. You know, I have a lot of stuff. You know, from the time.
I want to see those photos.
I kept some of the clothes. I've got some of the pictures. You know, I have a lot of stuff. You know, and you know, I don't want to sell it. You know, it's kept very well.
Yeah, save it for a rainy day when you need a few thousand. Sell them on eBay.
Oh no, I never would. You see, I never would.
So any final thoughts on punk? You know, is it alive? Is it dead? You know, it's funny how, you know, people on the leather jackets within sort of a few months of it being widestream after Bill Grundy and everything were going, the real anarcho-punks perhaps, like Crass. Crass wrote a song saying punk's dead or something like that, didn't they? What did you think about all that, Glen? You know, did you kind of have any kind of middle ground with any of those anarcho-punks who were kind of more nihilistic?
Not really, no.
So that's...
I've always kind of ploughed my... Not lonely, but my singular kind of furrow with whatever I'm doing. And when you're doing something, you're kind of really caught up in doing it. And that's kind of enough, really. You're aware of certain things that cross your path, but...
Will you do? Is there any chance you think that the Pistols might at some point do new material?
No, that's never going to happen. No. I think really? If ever we was going to have done that, that would have been in '96, and that's quite a long time ago now.
And how was that when you got back together? Because obviously you were sacked from the Pistols, which
well,
is obviously
a differ about that.
Yeah, sure. Right. Sorry. Okay, so that's how some people see it. But you left. Sorry. Yeah, you were right. You said in somewhere that you actually left of your own volition, but. You know, how did it all come back together again? You always kind of kept in touch with those guys?
No, we hadn't spoken for a long time when I was in the States, and I mean, it happened, you know. It happened, and the time was right. A lot of things in life, it's when the time's right to do something.
Yeah.
You know, when we have played with the Pistols, people have said, we kind of, I suppose it's 3 years ago now, the last lot of gigs. People said, it's much better than the last time you did it before. Well, I don't think so. I think it was exactly good, but I think the mood was kind of a bit more on our side.
I'll tell you what, there's a brilliant, I think Julian Temple did it, the recording of the Brixton Academy concert. It's absolutely brilliant. And there's a great scene where John Lydon forgets some of the lyrics and they show your face, you looking at him, like giving him a ticking off via your facial gestures, because he'd forgotten it after all those years. Mm. But it wasn't a problem, obviously, but that's great. It's a really... what's that one called? I've forgotten what it's called now.
They'll Always Be in England.
That's it, yeah. Check that out. All right, then, we'll wind down. And where should they go for websites to check out info?
Or Anne Pigalle or Salon Bohemia, you know.
Go to the... Anne is absolutely brilliant. She's very punk in her attitude. But again, as Glen says, kind of Edith Piaf punk styly. Glen, anything you want to talk about? You mentioned your tour, your gigs
coming
up. Yeah,
I've got some gigs coming up. I'm doing a Strummerville thing next weekend on the 17th. I don't know. Is this programme going out by then?
This is going out on the 23rd, so people listening to this...
Cool, you didn't half miss a good gig on the 17th. Strummerville thing. On the 24th, I'm playing at that place in Putney, the Half Moon in Putney with my band the Philistines, and then I'm also doing the Leverwood Literary Festival, Literary and Rock and Roll Festival in Norfolk, which I did last year. It was great, actually.
Okay, so is your website, is it glenmatlock.com?
It's glenmatlock@greatwire.com.
That's greatwire.com.
Greatwire. Wire.
Grapewire. Glen Matlock at grapewire.com and annepigalle.com.
Yeah, the Broadstairs is actually on the 23rd. That's why I'm saying tonight.
Let's not,
I was in the know.
Sure, yeah. We'll know. They'll know what we're talking about. We're confusing
even
them.
Even if we don't.
Yeah, exactly. We don't have a clue. We're very
punk. If they want to find it,
we're off our heads on sex and drugs and rock and roll. And we don't have a clue what we're saying, but there you go. Some of us are in our minds anyway. Right, I think, final word, I think punk is a mental state. It doesn't matter what you wear, what you do. Well, obviously it matters what you do, but it's not about appearance. It's about, you know, how you feel internally. And I think that's what people forget.
Yeah, but I think the appearance side is important because it's like being in an army and you're showing your colours.
Sure.
Right, now you might look at me and I'm not dressed as a punk today, but I don't want to be because I get bugged in the street.
Yeah, of course, so, yeah. And you shaved off your
Mohican.
And
I've done my bit.
you've done your bit, come on.
Totally, I want
to... No, it's the new generation, they have to do their bit, you know.
I want to say thanks for all your brilliant stuff, Glen, being in the Pistols and everything, and thank you, Anne. But, you know, what you did with the Pistols is just amazing. I mean, I had an argument with an old punk friend once who used to bang on about the Pistols all the time years ago, and he kind of styled himself on Sid Vicious. And then, you know, about sort of 5-10 years later, I was saying, yeah, what about the Pistols and that? And he was going, oh, they're rubbish, you know, they can't play. And it's almost like he did the whole punk lifestyle and he loved the Pistols. I used to go, well, have you heard of Faust or Noy or Can? They're good as well. No, I don't care, I'm punk. Like, within 5 years, it was all over and he was just going on about REM when they were really commercial.
Well, obviously, you should choose your friends.
Well, no, we don't talk anymore.
Better,
basically.
Exactly.
I mean, he's in America, but do you know what I mean? It's kind of like, oh.
People are funny, aren't they?
Yeah. All right, well, look, thanks a lot, Glen Matlock.
People are scared. Yeah, and they
shouldn't
scared. Be.
Wake up.
Yeah, wakey.
Thank you, Glen Matlock and Anne Pigalle. I'm James DC. Go to atomicbark.wordpress.com for more info.